Emma from GoDPS, and I'm standing here with George Lynch, who is in just a couple of hours going to be performing his second guitar clinic here.
A lot of fans have been asking, are you going to have any upcoming tours or shows with either KXM or Sweet and Lynch?
Not Sweet and Lynch, and probably not KXM for a while, but I am going out with Lynch Mob.
Oh, you are? Okay. Yeah. What are you planning with Lynch Mob?
Well, we're going to Italy next month, which is April, do a festival there, and then we're coming back and doing a bunch of shows in the States up through October. And you can find out where those are at by checking out my site.
I know you've been working with ESP Guitars for several years now. Are there any
30.
New... 30? Well, there you go, 30 years. Are you working on any new models of guitars?
Actually, yeah. We're working on a new variation on a Tele, but it's still in the development stages, and it has been for a while. But that's something that's sort of long-term that we've been working on. And I also have my own guitar line called Mr. Scary Guitars.
Right, right.
And I make very limited quantities of those, and those are only just kind of for private sales, like if somebody kind of contacts me through my website. That's kind of a behind the scenes sort of thing. secret guitar building thing.
What makes a Georgian's guitar unique?
Well, I have a certain way of playing the guitar and you know, certain sound that I hear that I would like to hear out of my guitars and amps, and just over the many decades I've been playing, I've sort of figured out how I can make that happen more easily by the shape of the neck and the design of the pickup and the type of wood and so forth, as far as the guitar is concerned. And even smaller things like the kind of paint you use there's a lot of things involved. And not everything affects the tone as much as you'd think it does, but collectively it all does. You know, put it all together, it matters. But what works for me isn't necessarily going to work for somebody else, so that's why it's very subjective. Somebody might think, well, I really like the way, let's say, this guy plays guitar, you know, name a famous guitar player, so they go buy his model. They're not necessarily going to sound like him. There might be a little bit of the placebo effect happening where they think that they should sound like him because they have his guitar and his pedal and his amp. And I think really the larger point is that you're playing a guitar that makes it easier for you to play what you're hearing in your head. Make it less frustrating. It's always hard. It's always challenging and difficult to play an instrument. But the instruments have gotten so much better over the years. Even at the low end of the price spectrum, you know, you can buy. I'm kind of blown away looking at some of these guitars. I'm looking at these ESPs. I'm like, is that really the price? Is that the price of the case? Or do you get the whole guitar too? When I was young, I mean, you got a cheap guitar and you played like a cheap guitar and it was horrible and it was painful and it made it harder to play. So now kids can start out with something like that, you know, and which is fundamentally just as easy to play as a very expensive guitar in a lot of ways. You know, it won't have all the high-end quality aspects to it, which you pay a lot more money for. But you get fundamentally all the, you know, nice things that make the guitar easy to play and fun to play at a really cheap price. So, you know, there's no excuse.
Are there any current artists or bands that stand out to you right now? Someone maybe that you see that's continuing the tradition?
Which tradition?
No, rock.
Being good?
Yeah.
The tradition
being
of being
good.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's so many great bands in all the different genres. I'm not going to pretend to be a musicologist of current music, but and even some of the bands that I think are kind of new to me are still been around for probably like 15 years. So, like Animals, Leaders, and Meshuggah, you know, on the really heavy progressive end. I like bands like that. I think it was the guitar players initially sort of caught my interest, you know, because they're great guitar players. Thorndahl and Tosin, great players. And there's, you know, I mean, I listen to everything. I just think that I don't just listen for guitar players. I think the band thing is the bigger picture and the more important picture is the song composition you know, I really listen to singers more than I listen to guitar players. You know, I love old blues singers and R&B singers and people that really emote when they sing. And that's always what I try to do with my guitar, is just sort of mimic wind instruments and vocalists when I was starting out. So I wasn't trying to play like another guitar player. Yeah. I was trying to emulate a voice. Yeah, so I always thought talking guitar was the one that most spoke to me when I was younger.
What's been your favorite memory on tour or on the road? Any of your bands?
Usually when I get paid is my favorite memory, like after the show and they bring out big bags of money. Well, I can't think of a specific one, but just generally when you hit those milestones in a band where you've all worked really hard and you achieve something like, you know, recognition, like a gold record or, you know, playing a huge tour and a show, you know, in front of, 60,000 people or something, you know, at the Enormo Dome, and it goes well. Nothing beats that. You know, it's pretty exhilarating. Yeah. I remember my first big show. That was pretty amazing. I was scared to death, and that was at the Cow Palace with Dio on New Year's Eve in San Francisco, I think 82 or something. The first time I'd ever played in an arena.
Yeah.
Scared to death. You know, it's completely dark, and you see the lighters out there, and they turn the house music off, and they're leading you up there with the flashlights, and they're like, and you've never done this before, you know, and it's, wow, I was like almost frozen to the point where I couldn't play. I was very nervous. And when I got up there, I overreacted. I tried to overplay and overperform. And what I ended up doing in front of 18,000 people was getting back down on my knees. I was doing a guitar solo, and I kept going back and back. It was just like Spinal Tap. I couldn't get back up. So I was stuck back there, and the roadies had to come and get me up. I learned, yeah. I think.
Of course, and yeah, good luck tonight. We're excited to see you.